recording.
Okay.
Thank you.
A very good morning and a very good welcome to all of you today to our service of Holy Communion. It is a wonderful day for us to be able to come and to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. Of course, we have the glorious sunshine outside today, and we'll be praying that in the same way that we are blessed in that way, we'll be praying for similar blessings tonight at the certain occasion that will be occurring, which I'm sure I don't even need to name to any of you as it comes up. For today's service, we are still operating in a time of restrictions, which does mean that our Holy Communion service will be a communion of one kind. So that means that I will be consuming both bread and wine. When we come to serve and to receive communion together, you will be receiving just wafer today. You're encouraged, if you have hand sanitizer, to make use of that before coming. And when I come to give you communion, it will just be simply dropped into your hand silently, but if you wish to say a prayer silently in your head, of course that is very much encouraged, and I will be praying for you each individually in my heart as I give you that bread. So I believe that is most of what we need today. Any other notices? Bands of marriage. Good point. Thank you, Mark. Almost missed it. Thank you. So we do just have two bands to read for today. So I published the banns of marriage between Robert Edward Banish and Sarah Jane Rust, both single of this benefice, and this is the second time of asking. We also published the banns of marriage between Liam Harry George Winton and Tony Ann Bradshaw, both single and of the parish of Tottenhill, also for the second time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry, you are to declare it now. Wonderful. Well, let's just take that moment then as an opportunity to pray for this couple also, for both of these couples. Father God, we thank you for the gift of love, and we thank you for the commitment of both of these couples to come together with the gift of holy matrimony. We do thank you for this, and we pray for them in these days, weeks, and months ahead, as they prepare their hearts to come together for that service. Bless them, guide them, and be with them, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, we begin our service today with our first hymn. So please do remain standing and turn to number 194 in your books, King of Glory, King of Peace. Come along to our hymn together. Thank you.
Thank you.
seated. We begin with the collect. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We come now to an abbreviated form of the Ten Commandments with a response to be said just at the end, please. God spake these words and said, I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt have none other gods but me. Thou shalt not make to thyself any graven image. Word and ordinance through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with thee and the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
Amen. We have our collect for today. O God, who hast prepared for them that love thee such good things as pass man's understanding, pour into our hearts such love toward thee that we, loving thee above all things, may obtain thy promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We come now to our first reading for today, please. Thank you.
From the Epistle of St. Paul the Apostle to the Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 3 to 14. Blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us into the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the Beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded towards us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in all, one in all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom we also have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh with all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ, in whom ye also trusted, after ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom after that we believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance, until the redemption of the purchased possession, unto the praise of his glory. Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus, and leave unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for thy own amazing, making mention of you in my prayers. Here endeth the first lesson.
Mm-hmm.
Please do stand for the gospel.
The gospel is taken from Mark, chapter 6, verses 14 to 29. And King Herod heard of him, for his name spread abroad, and he said that John the Baptist was risen from the dead, and therefore mighty works do show forth themselves in him. Others said, that is Elias, and others said, that is the prophet, or as one of the prophets. But when Herod heard thereof, he said, it is John, whom I beheaded, he is risen from the dead. For Herod himself had sent forth and laid upon John and bound him in prison for Herodias' sake, his brother Philip's wife, for he had married her. For John had said unto Herod, it is not lawful for thee to have thy brother's wife. Therefore Herodias had a quarrel against him and would have killed him, but she could not. For Herod feared John, knowing that he was a just man, and a holy, and observed him. And when he heard him, he did many things, and heard him gladly. And when the communion day was come, that Herod, on his birthday, made a supper to his lords, high captains, and chief estates of Galilee. And when the daughter of the said Herodias came in, and danced, and pleased Herod, and them that sat with him, the king said upon the damsel, ask of me whatsoever thou wilt, and I will give it thee. And he swore unto her, whatever thou shalt ask of me, I will give it thee, unto the half of my kingdom. And she went forth and said unto her mother, what shall I ask? And she said, the head of John the Baptist. And when she came in straightway with haste unto the king, and asked, saying, I will thou give me by and by in a charger the head of John the Baptist. And the king was exceedingly sorry. Yet for his oath's sake, and for their sakes, which sat with him, he would not reject her. And immediately the king sent an executioner and commanded his head to be brought. And he went and beheaded him in the prison, and brought his head in a charger and gave it to the damsel. And the damsel gave it to her mother. And when his disciples heard of it, they came and took up his corpse and laid it in the tomb. This is the word of the Lord. Praise be to God.
Standing as we now say the words of the Creed together. Saying it all together.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten as Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, forever, begotten, not made, being one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us in the conscious Pilate. He sat with them to Herod, and the third day he rose again for all these scriptures, and they
invite Neil to come forward and to share our work.
The thoughts of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord, our strength and Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
The opening words of Paul's letter to the Ephesians sets the life of the Christian church in the context of the cosmic plan of God. He almost catches his breath in wonder at the very thought of God's loving purposes. Paul uses the word mystery in relation to God's plan for mankind, but for the believer, the mystery becomes an open secret. His letter will go on to give quite detailed advice about how Christians should live together day by day, but this advice should be seen in its proper setting. The Christian needs to live a moral life, of course, but our calling is more than that. It's about living the life we were created for, in tune with the God who made us. That is why it's perhaps right to agonise over the way our lives bear witness to the God we seek to serve. What should I do? When? How? Our gospel reading gives us the sinister account of the beheading of John the Baptist. Very seldom is this type of martyrdom required of the believer these days, although sadly, it does still happen in lands where persecution continues. But for most of us who believe, the element of self-sacrifice does continue. A sacrifice of time, of energy, and service. Incidentally, the early church created different grades of martyrdom. An old homily contains the following verse: "Precious in the eyes of God, the white martyrdom of exile, the green martyrdom of the hermit, the red martyrdom of sacrifice." So the idea of martyrdom was not that necessarily of losing one's life violently or tragically at the hands of a tyrant, but a life spent in sacrificial withdrawing from the world or living a demanding life devoted to God could be categorized as white or green martyrdom, depending upon the level of sacrifice that one endures. However, our main calling is to serve as we believe God desires for our lives. The encouraging news is that our frantic efforts in this regard are not the only force at work. Behind them is the force and majesty of God, His Holy Spirit, whose purposes will not be thwarted, even if we often fail to discern His will. The letter to the Ephesians takes us right to the beginning, reminding us of our dependence upon God and how much we really need to thank Him for. Even before we existed, and certainly before we consciously turned towards God, He chooses that we are to be in Christ and share that relationship between Father and Son. Just imagine the idea of actually having been chosen by God. It's one that is certainly worth dwelling on. It is the nature of God, the Son, to go out and show the love of the Father so that the Son and the Spirit can gather everything that is made back into the life of the Maker. Verse 10. This is what we are made for. We are designed to be part of the ceaseless flow of love between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Christians then live as people who know God's plan for the world. We know that God has made us to be part of His glorious life and love. We carry in our blood the very serum, the antidote to the belief that life is pointless or evil always triumphs. Our baptism, you might say, injects us with the Holy Spirit so that now, inseparably linked with our own weary, bored, unbelieving lifeblood, is the lifeblood of God, who creates, sustains, and redeems all things. And the life of God is irresistible, as Jesus' resurrection shows. We do need to make it our solemn and binding duty never forget the Christian calling to joy and hope, to praising and glorifying God. We do need to hold always before us the knowledge that the world fate are in God's hands, and he who has held it in love from its birth is not going to drop it now. Of course, as always, as part of his creation, we have a responsibility to care for his world. Particularly in these present times, I'm sure that we realise the environmental responsibility that we all have to cooperate with God to preserve the wonder of creation on this increasingly populous and polluted planet. Knowing the huge and final plan of God does not always help us to see where we're actually going every day. Many, many days, weeks and months can pass without any sign that God's final goal of gathering the world into Christ is actually being furthered. Most of our own plans in this regard are too clearly human and lead, if we're lucky, into the dust. And if we're unlucky, into apparent disaster. As John the Baptist waited to be beheaded, did he believe that things were still on track and leading to God's goals? It can't have been at all obvious. He'd been sitting in prison for some time, visited regularly by Herod. John was beginning to make this tyrant see that he was leading a life contrary to the will of God. Then one rash promise from Herod, and John is dead, and the opportunity gone. If, as Mark suggests, Herod continued to feel guilty about John's death, still it had no visible effect upon his future behaviour. We readers of the Gospel know the central role John the Baptist plays as God's herald to the coming Son. We also need to know that John did exactly what he was supposed to do, and yet it did not bring him fame, fortune, or friends. John fulfills his role by standing aside, making room for the Son, and continuing to bear faithful witness right up to his strange and tragic end. As followers of Christ, the crucified and risen Lord, who is the image of the invisible God and the fulfillment of all God's plans, we should perhaps not be surprised that our lives spent in praising and glorifying God and by living in the truthful knowledge of his overriding purposes will not necessarily make our lives easy. I recall the text given to me at my confirmation. St. Paul, talking of God the Father, writes, "We make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it." 2 Corinthians 5:9. Of course, we know that guidance is not always easy, but if we make it our aim always to please him, by reading his word, by prayer, by trying to discern his will and putting that into practice, we're on the right path. The summary of today's message must be that in the midst of trying or even tragic, solemn or ugly circumstances, in Christ we can find real encouragement to faithful witness and constant hope. Amen.
Neil, much to think and ponder on there, and encouragement indeed in what has been a rather turbulent couple of years. There is much hope to be had in the Lord and in the way he can still minister to us in it. In just a few moments we will come to prepare the table for Holy Communion. Just a reminder once again for how this will happen today. I will prepare the table in a few moments and then I will bring down the wafers down to the front, just down from the step to the front here, and bit by bit you'll be asked to come up to receive bread, and it will be just communion in one kind today, simply dropped into your hand and done so silently. Okay. So, quick word from Scripture, and then I will go to prepare the table. "Let your light so shine before men, they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven." I'll now go to prepare the table for today. Please stand for our next hymn, which is hymn number 66, Glory Be to Jesus. Hymn number 66, Glory Be to Jesus. Let's stand.
Truly
punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. With grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and curates, they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively work, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments, and to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and specially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee in thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succour all them, who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We briefly pause just to consider those close to us who may be in difficulty at this time. Truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways. Draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, make our Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels
do not presume to come to this thy table, but bless the Lord, trusting in thy righteousness, that I deny my mouth of thy great mercies. We are not of those who much as to gather us from us under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have blessed. Grant us therefore, be gracious Lord, so to be the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may make ever more dwelling in him, and he in us. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and it institutes and in his holy gospel command us to continue perpetual memory of that his precious gift until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And on the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." grateful hearts, having fed on the Lord, we give thanks now, saying together the words of the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
O Lord and Heavenly Father, be thy humble servants entirely desire by the power and goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and thy whole church may obtain remission for our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee, that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. And although we be unworthy, through our manifold sins, to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offences, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honour and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to stand together now to say the following words.
Glory be to God on high, and in earth peace to those towards him. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory.
very much for attending our service for today. Our thanks go to organist, choir, of course our preacher as well today, and for all of those who worked tirelessly in the background to prepare many different aspects of the service that are unseen but vital to the running of things. Final prayer of blessing to peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.